Hi, Dave.
Hi, Jim.
What you up to?
Nothing much, but it's nice to be here.
Yeah, welcome back.
Well, it's good to be here, but it seems like we haven't spoken in so long, but actually,
It's only been a week.
we have. Well, yes, but to our loyal viewers like your mom, it's been longer because our last podcast was with the mighty Q.
Yeah,
Key?
the Chi
Key?
Ranger. Chi
Chi.
Ranger.
Chi, like chia pet. Chi.
The Chi Ranger. The Chinese Chi.
Chai.
Whatever this shape is.
Yes.
Which was what, 2 weeks ago.
2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Should we tell them why?
Sure. Well, probably I would imagine with the 10 people that are sitting out there,
Exactly.
there's probably a few that were here last week
Yeah, we apologize about
that
that, everybody.
saw that train wreck.
Yes, it was a train wreck of a podcast that we decided to bury. We put a stake through its heart.
Yeah, that
We
was a
burned it, and you actually erased it that night, so it's
I
absolutely
did. I
gone.
actually deleted it before I took you
Yeah,
home.
yeah,
Yeah.
yeah.
It was a steaming pile of dog doo. Yeah.
Duty.
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
So we won't be having any of that.
Good.
Yeah.
No
Okay.
duty tonight.
Okay, so Ty says we're sounding good.
Good.
All
Looks like
right.
everybody's there and ready for
Ready for some action.
entertainment.
Yeah, so what do you got for me this week, Dave?
Well, I got a lot of things.
Well, first I want to say Happy Father's Day to
Thank
you.
you. Thank you
Yeah.
very much.
Because that
Yay.
Dave is a father.
I'm a dad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So how'd Father's Day go
It
for
was
you?
wonderful. I'm very, very happy. There's a tradition in my household of Father's Day breakfasts. And what happens is, for the last 3 or 4 years, my daughters and my wife have made pancakes.
Okay.
And what they do is they make pancakes and then they decorate the top of the pancakes as my face.
Well, that shouldn't be too hard.
No, it's not. And the results are always
Right.
really cute. And it's really, really fun, and I love it. And so that's enjoyable and
Right.
everything like that. And my daughter Amy, who's in kindergarten, made a nice little Father's Day gift, as they all do, for their fathers
Sure.
there. And it was very nice. And usually that incorporates some kind of artwork they've done, usually the
Right.
father's face.
Sure.
And every single year that they make something, they always put dots where my beard is, and then every year they give me service, which means they add more hair to the top of my head than's actually there.
There.
Exactly.
Right.
But
You know,
I always enjoy it.
Kevin said the same thing, Jalen Kev.
Yeah.
He said his son made a picture for him, and he was generous with the hair.
Yeah. Yeah. They are. Those things that
Yeah.
I think I'm the only bald daddy in the class, so it's just like, there you go.
Yeah.
So, but other than that, it was really fun. We had a
You
great
don't
time.
see many bald Japanese men, do you?
No, you see them, but they're usually older. You don't see a lot of young guys. Yeah.
But you do see a lot of the comb over.
Yeah, you do
You know
see a lot
where
of comb
now,
overs.
if for any you young people out there, a comb over is when the person's lost all the hair in the middle, and then they let the side grow really long, and they flip it up over the top. Now you can call that a comb over, or what I like to call it, the
I
barcode.
was gonna say that's what they call it over here too, the
Yeah,
barcode.
the barcode.
Ding.
Yeah, so you never did that though.
No, I never
I'm
did that.
so proud
I
of you.
promised myself I never would. I do have sprouts, as I call them. Sometimes I don't shave the top of my head as well as I should, and I have little sprouts. But other than that,
Now, you
it's nice
guys,
to be back.
I want to point out, Dave, show him
Yes,
your head.
of course. Well, this is not for the podcast,
The
so
light's gonna.
everybody who's listening to this can just imagine a shiny, shiny head of goodness.
Like a bowling ball.
Yes.
Now, I want to point out to everybody that Dave and I have known each other for 23 years.
Yes.
And you were pretty much like this when we met.
Yeah, I did have more hair on the top of my head,
Not a whole
but
lot.
not a whole lot.
Right.
But there was more hair there. But I just like, no, I promised myself I never would do a comb over. I never would do anything like that. And as a matter of fact, the biggest problem I had when I first came over here is I
You can
want,
put your
thank you very much, I'm blinding people,
hat
is that I wanted a shortcut, but a
on.
lot because of my age, a lot of the hairstylists say, "No, we'll get it bigger, and then it'll make it look fuller." It's just like I'm bald, just shave it. So there you go. But
Yes.
it's really quite nice.
So if you do the math on that, we've known each other for 23 years, so
Yes.
you were 23, 24 years old when we met.
Yeah.
And you were starting to lose your hair back then.
Yeah, I did. I started losing my hair back when I was in college. So I mean, very thin back
Now let
then
me
as
ask you
well.
something, Dave. When
Sure.
you and Now that's the good thing about Dave is he does not have a complex about this.
No, not at all. Not at all.
Same
Not anymore.
right.
Yeah.
Same as I with me at my fat. You know, When you were like in high school, did mm-hmm. you have a full head of hair?
Yeah,
full luscious head of hair.
When I was growing up, my hair was so thick; it was amazing. As a matter of fact, that was during the time when it was wonderful to be a kid because mm-hmm. you didn't have to worry about your looks. I mean, it was back in the 70s. So my criteria to get a haircut was when my bangs would touch the tip of my nose.
Okay, I remember those days. Yeah,
if I could touch the tip of my nose, okay, then I could get a haircut.
Okay,
I would get a haircut.
And then when did you start noticing you were losing your hair?
I think in my first year of college.
Okay, and was it like coming out in hunks? Or?
No. It was slowly going back. And I always had a high hairline. Mm-hmm. I always had a high hairline.
Oh, so, man, me too. Look at this.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't think I had a bald spot for a long time mm-hmm. until it really went bald. You know, it's just like kaboom, and then it was gone. So, no, it was gradual. If it had been fast, I would have been worried. I would have been afraid I would have been sick or something.
Sure. But of course, you're a hypochondriac to begin with.
Yes, I am. Thank you. What are you insinuating there? Yes, I am. But it's because I'm always sick.
Yeah. So, all right. So, yeah, very interesting.
The other thing that happened to me this week, and it's a sad thing, is my wife's uncle died.
Right.
My father-in-law comes from a very huge family. He had about 7 or 8 brothers and sisters. Mm. Now, the uncle that died lived in a city not too far away called Shizuoka, as mm-hmm. we've talked about. Mm-hmm. It's a quick drive away, but it's one of those things where, because the family was so large, there was a huge age difference between my father-in-law and his brother. There was almost an 18 or 20-year age difference between the brothers. Mm. So he was more like a father figure, somebody he didn't even know, because the guy had already moved out and probably got married when he was like 5 or 6. But here's what I wanted to bring up, because there's a cultural thing here, and we talked a little bit about this. When you go to a funeral over here, and you're a man, you're expected to wear a black suit, mm-hmm. all right? And it's just common, and you can wear them to weddings and other occasions. But to be honest, I've been to a lot of weddings, and a lot of people wear other colored suits.
Sure.
It's fine. But at a funeral, you're expected to wear a black suit.
And I would imagine with a wedding, if you're a family member, mm-hmm. you should be in black, probably.
Okay, yeah, I'll go with that. Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, sure.
Guests can get away with.
And you're supposed to, for a funeral, you're supposed to wear a black tie.
Right.
White shirt, black tie. Well, I have several suits, which I don't really wear very much anymore, mm-hmm. but I don't have a black suit. Now, I really hadn't had to go to any funerals for a very, very long time, but last year, one of my wife's uncles died, and I went, and I had a very dark navy blue suit, and I went, and I was forgiven because I'm a foreigner and all that kind of good stuff.
But don't you hate that?
But yeah, and I felt out of place, and I thought, well, I got to get a black suit, but then you forget about it. And then...
Because here's the thing, before we continue, uh-huh. if a Japanese person shows mm-hmm. up in a dark blue suit, mm-hmm. then they're just in a dark blue suit.
Yeah.
But if you show up in a dark blue suit, you're that damn gaijin that doesn't have a black suit.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. So, sadly, another one of my wife's uncles died a couple months ago, and he was a lovely guy. I knew him well. And, I didn't have a dark suit. I didn't have a black suit, and I really felt bad about that. So, anyway, this uncle passed away, third uncle. And so we thought, I got to get a suit. Mm. And so we got to, but, of course, when this happens, you got to get it fast because somebody dies, and then the whole ceremony is taken care of or takes place very, very soon after. Mm-hmm. So near my school, there is a men's clothing store that sells suits. And so my wife went there, first of all, to see if they had my size. Because when you're a person my size, I can still get things off the rack if I'm lucky. You know, we've talked about this. You'd have to order it. But she found a suit my size, but it was 50,000 yen. Mm-hmm. Which is about $500. Mm-hmm. However, it's 50,000 yen, and then you get the second suit for 1,000 yen,
right?
Which is about $10.
Right.
So, long and short of it, you get two suits for 25,000 yen. Mm. Well, it's just like, well, I don't need another suit because I've got several of them. Mm. But as we talked about this last week, well, I was just going to have to bite the bullet if mm-hmm. I had more time. Well, there's another men's shop across the street. So last Saturday, she decided to run over there just to see what they had. And they had a suit my size. Mm. And you didn't have to buy two suits.
Okay.
The one suit was 26,000 yen. Mm. But...
Uh-oh. Here we go.
You had to bring in an old suit in exchange.
Okay.
So that was the thing. So I was working, and so I didn't
what
really
have... What is this,
have,
romper room?
I don't know. See, this is why I wanted to bring this up. So it was the situation. I was working, so I couldn't go back to my place and find a suit, and I didn't want my wife, and I'm not blaming her, to get a suit. Like, no, that's one of my favorite suits. Don't give them that. Right. So fortunately, her father, who's much smaller than I am, had a very old suit, which they took. But it's just like, why is this so difficult?
Good call, Dave.
Yeah.
Good call, getting one of the pop suits. And yep. I guess it doesn't matter, does it?
No.
They just want you to bring something in.
And they were fine with it. And so I got a suit, and they hemmed up the pants and everything. And this is a suit where it has the expandable and, you know, can make the pants bigger and make them smaller and everything. And they were saying, you can use this suit for 20 years. Mm. Well, there you go. So I got the suit. And having that said, I didn't go to the funeral. It was actually, I guess, maybe the wake. Mm-hmm. The Otsuya is what it's called. And that was in Shizuoka. And I hate to say this, but I felt better in a black suit. I felt, okay, now I'm...
Sticking out, but not as much.
Exactly. Right. And, you know, when you're young, you can get away with it. But, you know, I'm in my 40s. It's like, get a suit.
Right.
Get a black suit.
If somebody died in my arena at the moment, I'd be screwed.
Yeah.
I don't have any clothes.
You couldn't,
like,
and you couldn't order something in time. It wouldn't be able to. So I was really lucky. So we bought it on Saturday, and my wife picked it up on Sunday the next day.
That is another thing that I want to point out that is really, really good about Japan is, like you said, you went in on Saturday.
Late afternoon.
Right, and they sized you up, and they had to make adjustments to the suit, like maybe sew the length of the pants or something.
That's all they did. I mean, that's the whole thing. I mean, it's not. They didn't tailor it like usually suits, like regular suits.
But they will do that overnight.
Oh, sure.
Because they know the importance of having to get to the funeral the next day or whatever.
Yeah.
And they don't screw around.
No. And the other thing I mentioned too, and you agree with me.
And they don't charge you out the ass for it.
No, they don't. It was very reasonable. Mm. Very reasonable. But I've bought suits in the United States. I've bought suits in Japan.
And you don't have to tip.
No tipping at all in any situation. I was going to say that I've bought suits in America, and I've bought suits in Japan, and I've bought inexpensive suits in both countries. Mm. And wow, the quality of suits, the quality of an inexpensive suit is so much greater than the quality of an inexpensive suit in America. I've bought suits from good department stores, from good places that have fake pockets.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that they don't have a pocket that almost just looks like a pocket. I've never gotten that in Japan. This suit that I bought, it's very nicely tailored. The pockets are there. It looks great and everything. It's just buy suits in Japan. They're great.
Yeah, the last suits that I bought were, and it was a twofer from a tailor, actually. But I didn't spend a whole lot of money, maybe $600 or something.
For two suits, that's good.
Yeah, but that was for my wedding.
Yeah, oh, you had a good suit for your wedding.
The two suits that I wore for
my
wedding.
Sweet.
The suit that I wore for my wedding didn't have a collar.
Yeah, it was nice.
So it just came down like this, and it closed together. I kind of looked like a priest.
You did.
Yeah.
My father.
Yeah, and then in a wedding ceremony, you usually change, you know, 2, 3, 4 times.
Yeah.
We only changed once, so I changed from my black suit to my gray suit.
Yeah.
Which was a single-breasted, just regular suit.
With sequins.
Right. Yeah, sequins. Sequins. Fringe.
Yeah, exactly. With the fringe. Yeah, woo.
I'm
ladies and gentlemen, Elvis!
So, Japan's really good about suits.
Yeah, it's wonderful.
Yeah, they're really, really good about that stuff. And I didn't have to wait too long, a couple weeks.
Oh, wow. But that's a tailor-made suit.
Mine was tailor-made.
Yeah, mine was just right off the rack. So there
because I'm huge.
Yeah.
So happy Father's Day. And
thank you very much.
Father's Day was the day that you went to the funeral, too, right?
Yeah, exactly.
To the wake.
Yes.
And what time did you get back?
That's an also interesting question, too. It was much faster than we thought it was going to be, and we all drove in the same car, my wife, children, and my mother and father-in-law. Mm. And so on the way back from Shizuoka, he was like, we're hungry, we want to eat, because originally we were going to go out to a nice little yakiniku place and have Father's Day dinner, and so everybody was saying, like, let's stop by a restaurant. It's like, look at how we're dressed.
Right.
I'm in a black suit with a black tie. Obviously, we've just come from a funeral or wake or something. No, let's go to a supermarket, because there's a very good supermarket near their place. And we bought a ton of sushi and everything. And that's funny, too, because my wife and I both decided to go in. Because when my wife goes to buy food, she never buys enough. And when I go, I always buy too much. So it was absolutely the case where we bought just enough. We really we really evened each other out, and we were laughing about that when we were eating. Because it really was. It was just perfect. Everybody was stuffed, and we didn't have a whole lot left, so it was nice.
Well, I tell you what, Dave, let me tell you what happened to me today.
Even though
I've already told you.
Ouch!
But anybody that's following me on Facebook, you may have seen this already. But today I was laying on the sofa. This afternoon, it was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And I went to stand up, and you know how you're laying down, and you'll lift your leg up, and you'll slam it, you know, down to kind of get the momentum to flip up off the sofa.
Sure.
So I raised my leg up and threw it down, and the chair in our living room was actually closer to the sofa than it usually is. I guess Tomoko had moved it over or something. Uh-huh. I didn't pay attention. It's not her fault. But it's got a wood frame and wood arms, you know.
Yeah.
And my foot came right down on top of the arm, full power, slammed into the second toe, right next to my pinky toe, and I saw stars. I was screaming and cussing. You know, every F word was coming out of my mouth. And
fudge.
Yeah, I was sitting there looking at it for a few minutes, and I looked down, and there was blood. And I was like, oh, shit. You know, I really stubbed it, right?
Yeah.
And I reached down, and the toenail was actually split down the middle, and it was hanging off on either side. So I could just – it took a little bit, but I pulled it off. It hurt a little bit when I pulled it off. It's not, it doesn't hurt too bad right now.
Ouch.
I've got it bandaged up, cleaned it up with peroxide and put a Band-Aid on it.
Stingy.
Yeah. And I thought, well, you know, it's not too bad. I can walk, and it doesn't hurt too much.
Yeah.
And I put my shoes on to go outside to have a cigarette before. And as soon as I put my foot in my shoe, my toe wouldn't have any of that.
Nope. So
it was like, get me out of this shoe.
Yeah.
And then, of course, it was throbbing for like the next 5 minutes after that. So,
yeah.
Luckily, I don't work for the next 5 days.
Yush. Five?
Yeah. I don't go back to work till next Thursday.
God.
So this will give me plenty of time to stay off my feet.
You are so lucky.
Yeah, this worked out perfect. You know, this will be just a faded memory by the time I go back. Hopefully.
That's why you've got to be very, very careful about this. Feet.
Yeah.
The circulation of the feet is not good, especially if you're large like we are. And
right.
So you've got to be very, very careful about
right.
that. Yeah.
Yeah. So. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay. So what else you got for us, Dave?
Well, I apologize for everybody who's listening out there, but last week I went on a rant about Windows. And because we didn't publish that podcast, I apologize. I'm going to very quickly say a couple of things, because another thing happened to me on Sunday that was surprising to me.
All right, Dave, what happened with your computer?
Okay, well, first of all, I just want to warn everybody again, and this is exactly what I said last week. If you do have Windows 8 and you're considering updating to Windows 8.1, you've got to remember this is a huge update. You are basically reinstalling a operating system in your computer. It's not like one of those regular Windows updates. It will take hours. As a matter of fact, one of my students yesterday told me his friends did this. It took him 6 hours.
No, Christ.
6 hours to do this. And for me, it took maybe about 4 hours. So the reason why I'm saying this is that you've got to be prepared for this. If you're in Japan, and this is why I'm bringing this up, if you have Windows 8, you can have an English operating system, but if you do install 8.1, when it comes back up after 3 hours, it's going to be in Japanese. So you've got to have that all ready. Also, the thing is be prepared, because the only way you're going to be able to access your computer, which you bought with your new operating system, is by using a security code that they send you. Now, I don't know how they're expecting people who don't have a K-Tie. Luckily, I had it, so I could check my email. But if you don't put that security code in, your computer will not work. Okay. And also, you must have a Microsoft account. If you do not have a Microsoft account, you cannot access your computer. Okay. Now, you can later go in and reconfigure it so it's a local user and everything. That's what I did. But I just want to warn everybody that if you're going to do this and you're in Japan, you're going to need a lot of hours, period. You don't do this if you're going to go to bed early, okay?
Right, or if you're on your way to work.
Or if you're on your way to work, because it will take hours. Secondly, be prepared for everything to come back up in Japanese, okay? So if you need some Japanese help, you might. If you have your security code with your Windows 8 stuff, okay, have that ready, but have your KTi ready too, because they're going to be sending you the security access code, which you have to have, and you're going to have Microsoft a Microsoft account number, mm-hmm. which you probably do, but let's face it, you probably forgot it, because who the hell uses that?
One thing anyway. Real quick, for anybody out there that doesn't speak Japanese, KTi is a cell phone.
I'm sorry, I shouldn't.
That's okay.
I'm sorry.
It's something that... Yeah. That's just a word that we use every day. It's part of our regular vocabulary,
exactly.
and it's something you say you don't think mm-hmm. about. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, as I said, I want to make this rant very, very quick because it really is a warning. The things that 8.1 does is it reconfigures your computer. As I said, the only way you can access your computer originally is you have to hook up and be online with Microsoft. So you're always being watched by Microsoft. If you're... You know, you said I'm a hypochondriac. I also don't like to be watched, okay? Except now. I'm paranoid, yeah. But I just, you know, I don't like it. But having that said, they did a couple of things that are really nasty. For example, they're trying to push this thing called OneNote that they have on there, which I don't need. So they're always popping up, oh, join the cloud. And that's in Japanese as well. I had to reinstall the English mode into my computer. I think I might have made a mistake on that. Maybe I didn't have to do that. But another thing they did was instead... They put the OneNote in to access my printer because they're really trying to force you to use OneNote.
Mm.
So it's one of these things where it's just like I tried to print and it's like this thing came up. It's like, well, you need to use OneNote and then you have to sign on to use OneNote. You've got to be online to use OneNote, at least in my example. And then it's like, wait a minute, why is my driver not Canon? And so you've got to switch that back on. But the reason why I brought this up, too, is that last Sunday I wanted to call my dad by Skype
mm-hmm.
Just because I wanted to see him and everything like this. And here's the thing. Windows 8.1 uninstalls Skype.
Oh, okay.
And the reason why they do that is because Windows 8.1 comes pre-installed with Skype app.
Okay.
Okay. Now, guess what? The only way you can
use Skype app is if you're on OneNote.
Is not just OneNote, but by using your Microsoft account number.
Oh, okay.
Okay. And this is kind of weird too. So as I used my Microsoft account, and then all of a sudden it had all of my information and all my contacts. Huh. I didn't like that very much.
Mm.
So now, having that said, you can reinstall the regular Skype, and I did that as well, so I put that away. Right. But it's just be ready to have your computer be reconfigured.
Mm.
And it just and if you use OneNote, great. But if you don't want to use OneNote, which I have no reason for, well, you're going to be seeing this pop up all the effing time.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's like we were talking before we got on here about the iCloud stuff.
Yeah.
You know, like I don't use iCloud. I've got it totally turned off here.
Yeah.
And it's not that I'm paranoid. Mm-hmm. I see a lot of people complaining, oh, the NSA, the government's watching. The government doesn't give two shits about people like us, okay? We're nobody,
mm-hmm.
right? I don't fear that the government is watching me. My point with not using the iCloud is people, data doesn't just float up in the air. It's on a server somewhere.
Exactly.
It's being saved somewhere, and I'm fine with that.
Uh-huh.
But if something happens to that server, I lose all my stuff.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
All of a sudden, the cloud's not free anymore. You got to get some money to them
to
access
your
stuff. I can totally see that.
So I just I like to keep everything here.
Mm.
I've had iTunes for a dozen years, and I've probably only bought 3 songs.
I see. I love iTunes. I've bought a tremendous amount of music.
See, I don't buy music on I still buy
CDs.
I still buy CDs because, again, if this goes down,
yeah,
I've got everything on a shelf right here. It's safe,
mm-hmm.
and I don't have to download anything.
That's right.
So.
So anyway, I want to cut this short. I just wanted to give warning to people living in Japan because it could be nasty. And I really, when I was doing this, I was thinking, well, thank God I know enough Japanese to know what's going on.
Mm.
And thank God I'm not really tech savvy, but I know enough about Windows 8, and I was figuring out what was going on. Windows 8.1, and I got it in English too, so I really was able to figure out what was going on. So it's like when my printer didn't work, it's like, why is my printer not working? What? why does it go to one note? And it doesn't work.
Right.
Why? What? And so I just put my driver back up to top and everything like this. It's just very, very, very annoying. So think twice before going to Windows 8, which you're going to have to do if you're going to use a Windows computer.
Well, eventually, yeah.
Yeah, and you're going to eventually have to get at Windows 8.1, too, for a lot of updates and things like that. That's why I decided to do it.
Right.
But just give yourself plenty of time. And then I want to stop talking about Windows.
Okay.
Bye-bye,
bye,
rat.
Windows. Bye, Windows. So. Now, I don't usually, we don't usually address the comments at while we're in the middle of this.
Okay.
But Michael Marino is asking me, Jim, what's the picture in the corner?
Yeah.
The white one there. Dave, can you grab that?
Sure,
there?
I will be more than happy to, because you got a gimpy foot.
Yeah, I got a gimpy foot. Bring out the gimp.
There we go.
Okay. This is actually a picture.
Oh, you can see my fat.
This is a picture of Edward Van Halen that I drew. People that are in the room at the moment can see this.
Mm.
Yeah, I drew this back. I think the date on it is 1993. I drew that.
Wow.
Yeah. So.
Wow. That's pretty amazing.
Have it sitting back there. I haven't had a chance
I'll
to
put it in a safe place. So
I have it laying up here.
Oh, perfect.
So I haven't had a chance to hang it on the wall yet. It's just kind of leaning back there.
That'll look good on the wall.
Yeah.
That'll look very good. Good.
All right. So what else we got, Dave?
Well, we got a lot of stuff, but I didn't know if you wanted to talk about a special question first or if you want to wait that later. But I wanted to congratulate you about something, and that is you've started on your YouTube channel doing something that's called Weighing In.
Mully Weighs In.
Mully Weighs In. And I've watched the episodes that you've done, and I've really enjoyed them. And, I mean, I'm not really into heavy metal music that much, but I just enjoyed it, and I think it's a great little thing.
Well, anybody out there, don't worry. The next one will not be music-related.
Mm.
That's one of the things Dave said to me, that you might want to make the next one kind of steer away from music. Well, I got to do music eventually.
Sure.
I've actually got so many people were asking so many questions about music.
Mm-hmm.
I figured, well, I'll go ahead and do it. But I've got... You saw it before. I've got like 10 pages here of questions. So
and good questions too.
Yeah. So the next one will be something different. But I want to add something to people watching this and people listening.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be a new piece.
Huh?
There's going to be a new piece to the Mully Weighs In.
I didn't know this.
I was telling you this.
Oh, Eric, was I?
Yeah.
Ah. Okay.
Eric Surf 6. Mm-hmm. God bless him. He left a comment on my face. I think. On my video,
mm-hmm.
He left a comment on the video.
Mm-hmm.
He said that I should finish the video weighing in.
Like on an actual scale.
Checking my weight on the scale.
Mm.
And this may help me focus on a diet and, give me some responsibility here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, I think on next Mondays I'll do the first official weigh-in.
Oh, okay. That sounds like a great idea.
And then I'll weigh in... On each episode. Now, the episodes are going to be on Mondays and Thursdays.
Okay.
So I'll finish each episode by weighing in.
Now, having that said, I mean, don't put too much pressure on yourself because, I mean, over the course of 2 or 3 days, there's really not going to be a lot of change, right?
Right. Well, I'm going to have to be consistent on that because if I plan to do it every Monday, what if something happens where I skip a day here, skip a day there? Mm-hmm. So it'll be just easier to do it each time.
Okay.
You know.
Having that said, can I ask you a favor?
Sure.
Wear socks when you do this.
Why is it?
Because I mean, one of my favorite channels, Van Awesome.
Nah.
He usually does this, and you see his feet, and I don't really enjoy that. Now, especially with your nasty ass toe, I don't really want to see that twice a week.
My blood toe.
Yeah. Like, damn.
Maybe we can make that a part of the watching my toenail grow back. Maybe I can set a camera on my
toenail.
That's
what YouTube is all about: cat videos and watching toenails grow back.
And
criminy.
Do a time lapse on my toenail.
Oh, a time lapse on your toenail. Right. Yeah, get some special effects in here. Yeah.
Right.
Oh Lord! And you know the worst thing is you probably get a ton of hits on that. Oh, you know. It's the toenail time lapse channel.
Like you see those videos of those
Yikes.
People that do a daily picture for like 5 years.
Uh-huh.
And you see
those are fun.
Right. I could do that with my toenail.
Yikes.
You know, watch my toenail. Let it grow out to like 6 inches long or something.
Ouch.
Okay. All right, Dave. Well, let's go into my question here.
Okay.
This was actually sent to Tomoko.
Okay.
Someone sent this to Tomoko. Mm-hmm. I don't know who it is.
Okay.
They sent,
mysterious.
They sent this to Tomoko and asked her to ask us to copy to touch on this subject.
Okay.
Why they didn't come to me, I have no idea.
They were shy and they were nervous because they thought you might be angry.
That could have been it. Anyway, the person says, I'm interested to know about the differences in the level of fluency attained by long-term foreigners in Japan. For example, are there long-term foreigners who are still not fluent?
Yes.
I think it would make an interesting topic, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It is an interesting topic. Do you want to start or do you want me to start?
Go ahead, Dave.
Well, I'll be honest with you. I'm a long-term resident of Japan, and I am definitely not fluent. It goes up and down like a roller coaster. I'm, at the moment, not very fluent. There are certain – we talked about this in the last podcast that never got broadcast. There are certain situations that I can speak better than others, especially when I'm ordering donuts. I'm very good at that. But there are other situations where I'm not, and sometimes it gets very, very embarrassing. As a matter of fact, just this week, one of my students' mothers was asking me a question, and I knew exactly what she was asking me, but I couldn't answer it as fluently as I felt, because I've been here for 23 years. Now, I've had a lot of conversations with this, and I know a lot of people have commented on this. I know Victor's have talked, Victor's talked about this and everything. My personal opinion is a very large number of people that I've known who have stayed in the Eikaiwa field, as I have, tend not to be very good at Japanese. And I've also found that if people don't obtain a certain level of Japanese in a very immediate amount of time once they've landed in Japan, they tend not to be good at it for a very long period of time because, like me, they've discovered how you can get around things, you know. And, well, I'll be honest with you, some of it's laziness, some of it is also because all day I speak English because that's my job. And then I go home and I want to speak English to my kids because that's how they learn. And there is some laziness. Now, as I said, I can speak. My writing is maybe, again, it's low right now. It could have been a little bit better than you, but you're quite fluent. But that's because there was a long period of time that you were a male model.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you were doing lap dances, and so that really helped your ability. Oh, we're getting smarmy again.
I was a man slut. I wouldn't say that I'm fluent, but I can get around on my own. I can sit down and have a conversation with people. I can handle myself in most situations, but there are a lot of times that, just like you, something will come up and somebody will say something. I'm like, yeah, I don't know what you mean by that.
Yeah.
Actually, just last week, this is actually pretty funny.
Well, there you go.
Last week, the credit card company called me.
Ah, okay.
Okay. Now, you guys got to remember, the people that are calling from the credit card company, they're going to use a very formal level of Japanese, which is something that I've never really studied.
Yeah.
My Japanese is daily, you know, man on the street. So she calls me, and I'm following what she's saying, but then she's telling me about this paper that I need to fill out, and I don't know what that paper is.
Yeah,
I have no idea what it is. And I told her, I said, I'm sorry, I don't understand that in Japanese.
Yeah,
and so she said it really slow, and I said, it doesn't matter how slow you say it, I still don't understand it.
Well, at least she didn't say it loudly. That's what Americans would do. I'm going to yell this because I'm thinking a high decibel will make you understand better.
Right, but she started saying it really slow. And I said, you could have... No matter how slowly you say it, I'm not going to understand what you're saying. So I was like, call me back after 6.
Exactly, because then you hand it over to your wife.
Right.
And again, that's another thing as a foreigner who's been married for a while. It's like, have your wife handle it, you know, or what have you.
Yeah.
Now, just in the last couple of weeks, I've been really considering getting back and hitting it. You know, my Japanese is like you're dieting. Sometimes we really hit it, and then sometimes we don't. And there are several reasons for it. One is just for a business standpoint, I really personally feel that a lot of the Eikaiwa is going to be moving towards more of a juku, which is like a cram school kind of thing, where I think it would be very useful for me to be able to more thoroughly explain certain grammar points in Japanese and everything. And I can't really do that very well now. So this is a business standpoint. Another situation is there are times when I would really like to be able, in an emergency situation, to be able to explain what's happening in Japanese. And I'm nervous about that.
Right.
Having that said, I mean, there's so many different aspects of any language where, you know, until you really spend a tremendous amount of time, there are going to be holes, there are going to be gaps,
sure,
and everything like
sure,
that.
Sure, sure, sure.
But yeah, getting back to his question, because I think I've gone on a tangent, the majority of people that I've known in Shizuoka that have been here for a long time actually don't speak very well.
Mm, yeah, yeah.
Now, that could be different in Tokyo and everything. And I know some people that speak very, very, very well. Mm. And I know one person who worked for, you know him too, who worked as an interpreter for the mm-hmm. city.
Sure,
right?
Sure, sure.
So, of course, he can speak and read and write really well. But I have known probably the majority of people that didn't speak very well, and that actually asked me to do some help for them. It's like, whoa, wow, you must be really bad if you're asking me for help.
Yeah, well, and, you know, another example is Kurt.
Yeah.
Kurt was here 10 years. Mm-hmm. His Japanese
was... he here for 10 years?
Yeah, yeah.
Gee whiz, it always seems like he was here for only like 2 or 3.
No, he was here for 10. His Japanese wasn't very strong, and he admits it. He knows it. That was one of his frustrations was that he couldn't follow things that were going on, and he couldn't express himself the way he wanted to. He would, you know, he like most foreigners, you learn the key phrases.
Yeah.
You know, the greetings and, you know, how to ask for things and stuff like that. And Kurt would be on video and he would run into somebody on the street and he would say something to him. And then he would start getting a flood of messages saying, oh, your Japanese is so good. Yeah. You know, all these people, you know. And he's like, no, it's not. And I'm like,
No, it's, I agree. And, you know, anybody that knows me is watching me is like, yeah, Dave, your Japanese really
But with stays. That said, I think the main point of this is that you can come over here. And you can learn the key phrases and survive.
Yes, and I mean, this is going to sound like an excuse, but it really is true. For many Eikaiwas, English schools, English conversation schools, there is a rule that you cannot use Japanese in class.
Right.
And I worked for the Nova Corporation. Mm-hmm. That was a huge tenet.
I broke that rule all the time.
And there were many reasons for it, and there are many people that broke it, and I broke it sometimes too, simply because... after a while you live here, certain words become part of your vocabulary, whether you like it or not. When I go back to America, I use those phrases too, and I have to catch myself. But one of the reasons is because it's sold as an immersion situation where you are immersed in the language. And one of the things at my school is I tend not to use a lot of Japanese. I'm still fighting that for several reasons, because the more Japanese you use, the more the student wants you to speak in Japanese, and then pretty soon it's as in any situation when it's language and English in this country, it's 80% Japanese and 20% English, and then they think they're really improving and they're not even speaking the language anymore.
Right.
The other situation is that the more Japanese you lose, the more they're expecting you to be a walking, breathing thesaurus and translator.
That's true.
Which I don't want to be, and I think that's useless as well.
That is true.
I'm ashamed of my level, actually. But I've accomplished a lot in this country without being able to be totally fluent. So there are some people. Now, the other thing that I wanted to ask you about this is I have actually met some people, foreigners, that have reached a certain level of ability, and they tend to really look down on other foreigners who've been here for a while. And
I hate those people.
Yeah, and it's like, oh, you can't speak.
It's a throat punch right there.
Exactly. It's just like, what's wrong? Why? Well, it's because I've been working. What have you been doing? Oh, I came here to learn Japanese calligraphy, so I've just immersed myself. Well, I had to make a living, buddy, so sorry, you know.
Yeah. I learned my Japanese through, you know, working.
Yeah, a great way to do it.
I got out of the teaching field and got into where I worked in a Japanese company. I actually worked in a warehouse, stacking boxes, driving a forklift, you know, building pallets and stuff like that, where nobody spoke English. So, I was, you know, immersion. Right?
Yeah.
And then I did the driving thing for a while. I drove in that taxi service. Remember that?
Yeah. I love those stories.
Yeah. So I did that for a number of years, and then it was all right. Let's get back to English. Start making some money again.
Exactly.
I tell you what, Dave. I think it's about time we take a break.
We do take a break. We've got a new sponsor, don't we?
We do have a new.
Awesome.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have a new sponsor tonight. Big Paul Snack Foods.
Yes.
Big Paul Snack Foods, out of Houston, Texas.
Wow.
Out of Houston, Texas. They have graciously sent us a commercial.
Excellent.
So let's play that for everybody.
Absolutely.
And we will edit this into the podcast.
Yeah.
So
I'm just so happy that we're finally getting sponsored.
Yeah.
You know, that's great.
So anyway, here we go, guys.
Are you looking to have folks over on a Friday night? Or maybe you're even thinking about hosting a Super Bowl party. Well, don't let everyone go hungry. Run on out and get your hands on Big Paul's Big Nuts. Howdy, this here is Big Paul, and you can spice up any kind of gathering with my Big Nuts. High in protein and low in calories, my mouth-watering nuts will keep a smile on your face. Ooh, Big Paul, your nuts are so big. Careful, honey, they're salty. So make sure at your next shindig, everyone gets a mouthful of my Big Nuts. Big Paul's Big Nuts, they're swinging.
I love Big Paul's Nuts.
Big Paul's Big Nuts.
Yeah.
Big Paul's Big Nuts.
Yeah.
So I've heard that they're coming out with Big Paul's Big Wieners.
Wow.
Yeah. And the potato chips, Big Paul's Big Bag.
Big Bag.
Yeah. So
wow.
Well, hopefully we'll be getting those commercials from
them soon.
Absolutely.
That'll be great. I highly recommend Big Paul's Big Nuts.
That's right. For your next party.
Whenever you can put them in your mouth. Do it.
That's right.
Absolutely.
All right. So what else you got for us tonight, Dave?
Well, I mean, I was going to talk to you about that, and I think we've talked enough about that, but that's such an interesting question. So if I can just do one other thing.
Sure.
If you are going to come over here, again, as you said, you don't really have to know the language. As a matter of fact, you can really – why am I looking at myself? I look at the
right.
camera. Look at the green dot. You can really live well over here, especially in a big city like Tokyo, without speaking a word, okay? But you can get lessons pretty easily over here as well.
Mm.
And if you are going to come over here and you have any kind of desire to learn the language, start hitting it soon and fast. Don't wait and say to yourself, okay, well, I'll get accustomed to my working situation, and then after a couple of months, I'll try to find something and everything like that. Don't do it. Hit it as soon as you can. Okay, and don't go for the whole thing, oh, the best way to learn Japanese is find a Japanese girlfriend or boyfriend. That doesn't work either, because usually they want to practice their English with you.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what happens. So now I want to ask you something controversial about the language then, if I can.
Sure.
And one is, I think, I can't remember who said this, but maybe it was Victor, but I don't want to put Victor is give me a break man. I can't remember if it's give me a break man or give me a flake man. And he basically said that
he's both.
He's both. Mm. Are you telling me he's bi?
He swings both ways.
He swings both ways. Yeah. Yikes.
Break man and flake man.
Yikes. But he was saying something.
You know, Victor's Jewish, right?
I don't. Well, my stepmother's Jewish. I don't care.
Victor Brakeman.
Victor Brakeman. Victor Brakeman.
Yeah.
There you go.
Anyway.
What was I going to say?
Something controversial about
Something controversial. And that is, he was saying, or somebody was saying, that it's kind of a waste of time to learn Japanese. Now, not for us, because we live here and everything, but if you think about it, there's such a, they keep saying there's so many stories that the population is decreasing. In some ways, you could argue Japanese is a dying language, because where else in the world, except in this country, is it used in any way, shape, or form?
No way.
So unless, and if you're going to be doing work with a Japanese company, in most cases, the people that you'll be talking to, their English is going to be way better than your Japanese would ever be, because of the emphasis they put on English and the level they have to be able to get into a situation where they're working in another country. So, I mean, that could be used as an excuse. Again, I'm in a situation, you're in a situation where, no, you got to know the language, because I've got daughters over here, and I've got situations where I've got clients who are Japanese where I really would like to be able to talk to them. It's not because I'm lonely. It's not like, I want to make Japanese friends. No, I don't have time. Hell, I barely have time to ever see you, you know.
Mm.
So
yeah, that's the thing. Like for me, you're basically my only foreign friend here. Yeah, like in this area.
Yeah,
I mean, obviously, there's Kevin out there and Victor, and you know, the
actually,
people
can I stop you right there? You're lying. You don't like any of them.
Can't stand them.
You said that many times. You hate them all.
Hate them all.
Yes.
You know, obviously, the people in the J vlogging community are my friends, but
sure,
the people that I see on a daily basis, other than you.
Mm.
Everybody I hang around with is Japanese.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so I'm four, and none of my friends speak English.
Yeah,
very little.
Exactly.
You know, Hagiwara gives it a hell of a shot. You know, gives it the old college try. And you know, you've seen him on video trying that. But yeah, I Yeah, I guess I get my training just hanging around with people.
Yeah, exactly. But again, I hate it too because I mean my kids are, you know, are going to school, and so when I have to go to Parents Day and everything, it's not like I talk to the other parents or anything. But they're not really chatty either. But I mean, and I can say hi and everything. But I mean, you know, that kind of thing. So yeah, if you're gonna stay here long term, learn the language. Don't be like me. You know, and God knows I have cracked the books. I even went to a Japanese school.
You did.
But for about a year, and that's when my language ability got up pretty well. But I was also still working and teaching English, so I was doing that too, and it really didn't help matters much.
Yeah, you know, teaching every day, hanging around all the foreigners in the school, going out drinking with the foreigners at night.
Yeah,
when are you gonna learn Japanese?
Exactly.
You know?
Exactly.
So. That's a big thing.
It is huge. So I really hit it hard, hit it strong. What, just like with life, really.
Hit it.
Now, let me ask you another controversial question, and we're going to get in so much trouble living in Fujita, Japan.
Okay.
But James.
Yes.
Are you aware, as an American, are you aware of this, because you may not be, that apparently in the world right now, I think in a country called Brazil, there is this thing called what they say a World Cup of some kind?
Yeah.
Yes.
This is where we're gonna rile some feathers.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So yeah, tread lightly.
Yes. Oh, definitely. And this is one of the reasons why I bring it up, because Fujita, Japan, is huge on soccer, and Shizuoka Prefecture, really, I guess we could say manufactures, because they're like little robots, little soccer playing robots. As a matter of fact, a couple years ago, a huge percentage of the members of the World Cup team were from this prefecture.
Right.
And one of the players on the World Cup team is from this very city, Fujita.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's his name?
I have no idea.
I forgot. And I was saying it all day, too.
Well, you know, Dave, the other day, America played, I think they played their first match, and they won.
Guyana, I think.
Ghana, yeah.
Ghana,
yeah.
Guyana.
Yeah, they played Ghana the other day and they won.
Like
and
or whatever.
I put a tweet out that said, "America wins a soccer match. Mm-hmm. 7-year-old girls around the nation rejoice."
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh, now, James.
Now it wasn't long that I started getting hate messages from people. Mm-hmm. You know, getting on me about this. Yeah. Okay, and I was like, the first thing that struck me was like, people, read the air.
Yeah.
Read the air in the room. That's something they say in Japanese. Kuki onde kudasai. And read the air in the room. Mm-hmm, get the feeling of what's going on. I was not ragging on soccer. Mm. I was not ragging on the Brit. And this is a British person. This is what I'm saying. I was not ragging on the love that British people have for soccer. I was making a joke. How Americans don't have an interest, that big of an interest in soccer.
Yeah.
That it is still pretty much a kid's game in America. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not knocking soccer. If England wins a game and the entire country rejoices, I totally understand that.
Absolutely.
I respect that.
Yeah.
That's their sport.
Mm-hmm.
But the subtlety of the joke didn't go over.
No.
And I started getting, hate messages from people, and the guy said to me that soccer is a man's game, helmets and pads are for sissies. And I'm like, well, wait a minute, soccer and American football don't really they don't compare like that.
No.
Okay, if you want to go with rugby, that's fine.
Yeah.
But no, soccer is an entirely different
no.
game. And then he said something really rude, that if the Bengals won the Super Bowl, meatheads all around Cincinnati rejoice.
Mm.
And I thought that was just rude.
That was rude.
Yeah. You know, that was just...
accurate, but rude.
Yeah. Accurate, but rude. Yeah. I resemble that remark.
But no, I mean, I'm not very interested in soccer anyway. But I mean, in this area, when you're dealing with a sport that is so popular, especially in this town, where one of the members...
I have no idea what his name
is. I'm sorry, I can't remember. I'm so old now.
His
number is 17.
Dave, I wouldn't know his name if I heard it.
Okay.
I wouldn't know what he looked like if he was sitting right in front of me.
Okay. But I mean, there's a love for the sport here.
But I know there's a guy from the city on that team.
There's a love for the sport, so I've got to respect that, and I've got to be careful of it. But like last Sunday when they had the game, it was so funny because I was in the other room working with Windows and Skype and getting all that done and everything. And my daughters, my wife, were watching the game. And the problem with my wife is her scream for seeing a cockroach is the same as her scream for being excited with soccer. So I'm like, ah! And I ran into the other room with a, you know, with a shoe in my hand, like, where is it? But the other thing that was interesting is I decided to work out last weekend. Mm. So I walked down to a very lovely exercise place we have here, a common place. It's a local place.
The Budokan.
Mm. And oftentimes on the weekends, it's just packed, the exercise training place. And when I went there, it was in the second half of the game, it was empty. For the first time ever, there were literally zero people. I was the only one. And so everybody in this town was glued to their TVs watching this thing.
You know, I was at school this morning, and even in the middle of class, the teacher leaned over and she said to me, "Do you know if Japan won the game this morning?"
Yeah.
And I said, "I have no idea."
Yeah.
So, like, when the kids were writing, I just pulled my phone out and hit Twitter real quick, just to see. And there weren't any messages. Mm. So I hit Facebook and opened up. There weren't any messages there. So I put my phone away and I told her. I said, "Yeah, I don't know." And then when class finished, we have like a 20-minute break. So I pulled it up on the computer.
Sure.
I pulled up Yahoo, and it was there that Japan had tied with whoever they played today.
The draw. Greece.
Who? Greece. Okay. So. They drew.
I don't know.
They drew. They tied.
It was a tie.
It was a 0-0 tie, and
we really can't speak English anymore.
There were two teachers standing there when that happened, and both of them gave out this sigh like, right? Yeah. And I was like, well, it's better than losing, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, no, because that means they can't. They're not. There's just really no way that they're going to be able to go on in their bracket.
Okay.
Yeah. Well, why don't we get to the peanut gallery?
Well, one other thing.
Oh, okay.
About the person that was getting on me about the this English person that was getting on me about soccer. The joke that I made, 7-year-old girls around the country rejoice. That would be the same as if I said, the NFL went to England and 5 people showed up.
Yeah.
That's exactly what it is.
Yeah, exactly.
British people don't have interest in the NFL. Mm. I respect that. It's not their. It's not their game.
Yeah.
Okay, anyway, so let's get on to the peanut gallery.
I would imagine there are a lot of questions about where people can buy Big Paul's salty nuts.
Yeah. Okay, all right, so my buddy Rick over in Cyprus, hurry up, it's going to be dark soon. Hey, guys. Hey, guy, a warped wheel. Hey, guys, hope you're both fine. Yes,
you are,
we're fine.
Thank you very much.
Toshio Shiraishi. Hey, Toshio, I'm here. Yes, you are. Ty Barnes says you're going. Sounds good.
We appreciate that. We really do at the beginning.
Michael, you're good, Mully. Rick Kendall, boo. I think that's because we said there's no music.
Mm.
Chant Cohen, everything's good. Toshio, I heard that my uncle is the only one in the family who's completely bald. LOL. And then we've already addressed the picture thing.
Yes.
Toshio says he's thinning up there. The gene has passed down from father to son.
Yep, it does.
Yep. Charlie Brown says good day from Down Under. I actually was on Skype with him earlier this evening. Happy Berry Crochet. She says, I think sandals are the way to go. Youch. Poor Mully.
Yeah.
Sandals might be a good way to go, but at the same time, I was kind of thinking, well, for comfort, sandals would be the way to go. But when you're walking, that dirt kicks up, right?
Yeah, that's true.
And I don't want open toes.
No. You're going to have to keep that.
Yeah.
Going to keep that clean.
Yeah, you want to keep that clean. Mm-hmm. Kevin's in the house, J-Lan Kev.
Hey!
We want to give a shout-out to J-Lan Kev because he gave us a very...
Very nice. And we said this in the last podcast that went down the toy D, but that was really cool what he said, and I really appreciate that.
That was a very, very nice shout-out that he gave us. So in return, everybody that's here tonight, make sure you check out the Just Japan podcast with our friend J-Lan Kev, Busan Kevin. Anything you want to know about Japan... you can find out with him. His format is he interviews somebody each week.
Oh, that's fun.
And on a certain topic.
Mm.
And my favorite episodes are 1, 9, and 14.
Okay, can you tell me what the topics are then?
I was the guest.
Ah!
Okay, the first one was a long-term expat in Japan.
Mm.
Episode 9, I believe, was the music scene in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And episode 14... Oh, damn it, Kevin, I forgot what episode 14 was. Anyway.
It was the one after 13 and the one before 14.
Right.
There you go. Bada boom.
What were we talking about on that one? I don't remember. Okay, Sam says, yo, Mr. Kanji Kid, I caught this live by luck.
Yeah.
Dry Gin, the cloud never forgets, and it isn't as secure as you'd prefer.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree with that. You know, he's not the paranoid one. I am. The Americans kill people over metadata?
Dave. Yeah. They're looking for you.
Yeah, they're looking for me. No, I'm not that paranoid. Believe
me. Kevin says it's always fun to see people panicking about Windows.
Yeah!
Yeah. Dry Gin says, I use Amazon for my music purchases, usually a mix between CDs and MP3s.
Cool.
Kevin, thanks. Awesome work drawing that picture of Eddie. Thank you, sir. Warp Wheel, the GIMP. Speed's not here. Speed GIMP's not here.
That's right.
Jambo, P26, watching on mobile, guys. Great as ever. Thank you.
Mm.
Gaijin Komuso, Dave, did Dave do that to your foot after handicapping horses?
Yes, I right, did. Right. I'm very busting good at handicapping kneecaps. People, yes.
Hikipedia, Ohio. Now, Ohio. She's the one, I'm assuming it's a female because of the, I'm assuming this person is a female because of their avatar, but the video I made today was a direct request from her.
Oh.
About learning to play guitar.
Cool.
So, but, you know, ever since last week with the Wikipedia, I always want to say, Wiki Bear!
Wiki Bear!
I'm Wiki Bear!
I'm Wiki Bear!
Okay. Oh, Jay Lankev, yay, Mully's Blood Toe, the channel. Mully's Blood Toe, the
that
channel.
That would be huge. Absolutely huge.
Non-demo guy, what's up, guys? Wikipedia says, hello, my mom is guilty of the loud talking to foreigners to try and make them understand.
Oh, sure. It's what we do.
Who was it? It was, I think it was Steve Martin.
I don't know.
I can't remember. He made that joke. He said, why is it when we go to foreign countries, when we try to make a point, we slow down and put an accent on?
Yeah, I don't know.
And he says, like, you jump in the back, like you go to France and you jump in the back of a taxi and you say, yeah, I'd like to go to the hotel. And the guy comes up, blah, 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 blah. And he goes, I would like to go to the hotel. So,
sure. That'll work.
I guess you had to be there. Okay, non-demo guy, Big Paul Snatch Food.
That's nasty.
Yeah. Ninjaroo, LOL. Haha, Big Paul's Big Nuts. Our Big Paul, Warped Wheel, our Big Paul's Big Nuts self-saucing.
You don't want to know.
Let's see, non-demo guy, Big Paul's Fat Sack, which includes all of Big Paul's delectable treats in one big sack.
Yeah.
I may use that. Mm. Legit Outlaw, yay, Jess is out here. I'm so late. Mr. Dave, do you watch a lot of Japanese TV for language practice?
Yes, I do, actually. And not for language practice, and that's one thing that I should probably do. That's a thing that I should probably get some Japanese DVDs and watch them. Actually, a couple of animated movies are in Japanese and English, and you can do that. But I watch a lot of Japanese TV, and I understand most of it, and I enjoy it. Some of it, and I can understand what's going on. And again, that's the thing. My level is to the point where I can understand some of it, and then occasionally I do ask or check my understanding with my wife, and then oftentimes I'm correct, and then sometimes I totally miss it.
Now, for me, Japanese TV, I really like comedy.
Yeah.
The manzai, the two guys talking. You got the straight guy and then the guy that's kind of the clown. I like that. I like the variety shows that are like the skit comedy. And I'm not trying to say that I've got some superior level of Japanese, but I think you have to reach a certain level to understand their humor.
Oh, sure. And I mean, a lot of it, especially a lot of the humor is just a play on words.
Right.
And so if you don't understand the language, you don't get the joke.
Right. Mm-hmm. And also, the guy that asked for your language practice, he says, P.S. Mully is correct. You helped make this podcasting duo awesome. Keep showing up.
Oh, thank you.
Told you, Dave.
Thank you.
Okay.
I really appreciate that. I sincerely do.
Shut up, Dave.
Okay.
All right. Gaijin Komuso says, being English, find soccer, football, insufferable, as every other sport is better to play and to watch.
Oh, well, we're just going to leave that. We're not going to touch that.
No. Rick Kendall says, England are always expected to win every game, but we are not that good. Mr. Kanji Kid, are the roaches scarier in Japan than America? Do they fly more often?
Yes.
Really?
I never saw a big cockroach. Now, again, I'm from Southern California, so, we didn't have the big bugs. Yeah, the first time I ever saw a big, gigantic cockroach was in Japan. when in my first apartment. And yes, they can fly. And when I first saw one, I thought I told you this story. Didn't I tell you this story before in the podcast?
You probably did. Go ahead.
Okay, I'll tell it really quickly because I don't want to bore you. But I was entering my old apartment when I first came to Japan. Turned on the lights, and right on the wall was a gigantic, huge cockroach, the largest cockroach I'd ever seen at the time. And I thought that when you turned on the lights, cockroaches, out of just common courtesy, were supposed to scurry away. This guy, this huge cockroach, is basically lighting up a cigarette and saying, "What the hell do you want?" You know,
right.
Like, "This is my place. What the hell are you doing here?" You know. And so what I did was, is I got a shoe or whatever, and I was getting just about ready to hit the guy. And I didn't know at the time, because there was no internet to learn these things, I didn't know cockroaches could fly, and that puppy flew right at me, right at my face.
Oh my God.
And I screamed like a little girl.
Ah!
And I went out and I went to the nearest convenience store and I bought every single insecticide they had, and everything just bombed the whole place and everything like that. And it's just like I probably lost several years because of all of the garbage that I put in my body because of that. But yeah, it was nasty.
Okay, if you're wondering about cockroaches in Japan, just imagine the big palmetto bugs in Florida. That's anybody that's been to Florida and seen those, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Mm. Okay, so Jess is back. She says, "Hey guys, Dry Gin. To say teams tied is usually they ended in a draw.
Ah.
Though that's usually reserved for 0-0 scores." Okay.
Thank you for your English help.
Jess also tells me use a Band-Aid for the dirt.
Yeah.
Yep. April Schmaprel. Sad I missed
that.
So much. Great stuff.
April Schmaprel. I like
and
that.
And Emily Louise Maitland. Hello.
Hi.
With a smile. Hi, Emily.
Thank you.
Welcome to Mully's Place.
Very good.
Let's see. Oh, here we go. Paro Drew.
Mm-hmm.
If you like comedy,
Baksho Mondai.
Yeah, Cowboy is a great radio podcast, or so I've heard. Don't understand any of it. No. Okay, it's the same.
Baksho Mondai is a really good comedy group. They're really, really good.
Okay, I'll check them out.
They're nice.
I'll check them out. I'm really big on the Manzai, and I love Shimura-ken.
Yeah, I know you love Shimura-ken.
Shimura-ken is my, in the entire world, Shimura-ken is my favorite comedian. Mm. I don't think anybody's funnier than him.
You know, we might want to, because I know you got a lot of requests to talk about Japanese rock bands. I don't really know a lot of heavy metal rock bands, but I do know some bands and maybe some old TV shows of Japanese TV shows that we like, or what kind of shows we like. That might be a good podcast.
Yeah, it could be.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's think about that for the future.
I think too.
But I think it's about time to wrap things up.
I believe it is.
All right. Well, I want to thank we'd like to thank everybody for sitting in with us tonight. Mm-hmm. 34 tonight, Dave.
That's great.
34.
And I think this one's going to be published.
This one will be published.
I think this is going to go out there.
This one will be up here in about an hour or so.
Great.
I want to thank everybody for sitting in with us tonight. Anything that you want podcast related or Warmoth Strat related, you can go to www.mullysplace.com.
That question that Tomiko got was great. I really appreciate that. And those are really helpful for us.
Anytime you guys have any questions that you'd like to address, you can get us at Mully's Place on Twitter. Mm-hmm. The three of us, Dave, myself, and Tomiko, we share that account. So if you've got any questions, anything you'd like for us to address on the podcast, you can leave something there. You know, if it's interesting enough, we'll do it.
Yeah.
Anything.
If it's boring, we'll just totally ignore it.
We'll just ignore it. any links to any of this stuff will be at mullysplace.com. We want to thank Big Paul's
Snack
Foods for
their... It's so nice to
finally have a sponsor.
Yes.
And
maybe he'll be a special guest star someday.
Maybe someday we can get Big Paul out here.
Yeah.
All right. So I guess with that, we just wrap it up from there, right, Dave?
I think that's a great idea.
All right. Well, this is Mully.
This is Dave.
Keep it between the lines.
Oh, yeah.